Overactive bladder, also commonly known as OAB, is a condition of excessive stimulation of bladder that results in an urge to urinate and increased urinary frequency. Especially, urinary frequency increases at night. In a few people, leaking urine may be observed as a result of urinary incontinence. Controlling these symptoms can be accomplished in many ways. Behavioral therapy induces many lifestyle changes that can train people to control their bladders. A few exercises that strengthen pelvic muscles can also control urination. However, when these methods are not sufficient to control the symptoms of an overactive bladder, medicines can be used to relieve the symptoms. In this video, let's discuss the different types of medicine used to treat overactive bladder, how they work, and the facts to be noted while using them. Drugs used to treat overactive bladder act mainly in two ways. The majority of the drugs directly act on the bladder as relaxants. Anticholinergics and beta-3 agonists fall into this category. Other groups of drugs work either by modifying neuronal activity that brings bladder control back or restoring hormonal balance. Let's explore these medicines one by one. The first category is anticholinergics. Here we can see two suffixes in the names of anticholinergic medications. A few drug names end with the suffix finacin and a few drug names end with suffix terodine. Darifenacin and solifenacin come under the first group, while tolterodine and fesoterodine come under the second group. Other drugs like oxybutynin and trospium also fall into this category. Let's see how they work. All these drugs work in a similar ways on the bladder. The autonomic nervous system plays a key role in maintaining the functions of many organs in good balance for their smooth function. It has two divisions, the parasympathetic and sympathetic systems. The parasympathetic system works under resting conditions, and it is involved in the normal functions of many smooth muscles. It can affect various organs like eye, intestine, bladder, and lungs. Except for blood vessels, in all these organs, the parasympathetic system produces contractions. Interestingly, it causes relaxation in the blood vessels. However, it is not a direct effect. Instead, it is a nitric oxide mediated effect that results in relaxation. You can see our previous video on how acetylcholine produces vasodilation in blood vessels. Now coming to our topic, the action of acetylcholine on the bladder is important here. Cholinergic neurons are supplied to the bladder where they release acetylcholine as mediator. Bladder is expressed with muscarinic receptors of type 3. These M3 receptors can cause excitation in the target when they are activated. Here the target is nothing but the bladder. Normally, acetylcholine act on these receptors, leading to their activation. This brings release of two mediators. One is IP3 inositol triphosphate and the second is DAG, diacylglycerol. Both mediators increase the calcium levels within the muscle. This results in contraction of the bladder. Therefore, in people with overactive bladder, the contraction of bladder muscles can be controlled by limiting the action of acetylcholine. Anticholinergics work in this way. They selectively block M3 receptors in the bladder, thereby preventing the action of acetylcholine. This results in bladder relaxation, relieving the symptoms of an overactive bladder. It can reduce the urgency to urinate, and it can even reduce urinary frequency. As the bladder is relaxed, it can accommodate a large amount of urine, which minimizes incontinence. Most of the anticholinergics are available for oral administration, and they can be taken by mouth. Oxybutynin is also available as a transdermal patch and topical gel. Even though these medicines differ by the dose they are given, they still work in an equal way. The side effects produced by these medicines are mild and well tolerated. Acetylcholine is essential for inducing secretion from a few glands like the salivary, lacrimal, and sweat glands. Since anticholinergics block the action of acetylcholine, they cause a few side effects. Dry mouth is the most common side effect observed with anticholinergics due to inhibition of salivary secretion. Even though it is well tolerated, for a few people it is significant and troublesome. To relieve dry mouth, sugarless gums or candies can be chewed. Dry mouth is less pronounced with topical formulations. Oxybutynin gel or patches show less dry mouth as they release medication at a slow rate for an extended period of time. Anticholinergics can also produce dry eyes and blurred vision due to inhibition of lacrimal secretion. Constipation is another important side effect that is commonly observed. Again, acetylcholine is responsible for contraction of the GI smooth muscle. Anticholinergics blocks this action, which results in the decreased GI motility leading to constipation. Intake of fiber-rich foods can relieve constipation. Therefore, it is better to add avocado, strawberries, apples, pears, oats, lentils, bananas, and dry fruits to the diet. Nasal dryness, difficulty urinating, confusion, and memory problems are also often observed with these drugs. The second group of drugs are the beta-3 adrenergic agonists. Mirabegron is another bladder relaxant that acts in a different way. The sympathetic system can also control bladder contraction. However, it acts in quite opposite way to parasympathetic system. Acetylcholine increases bladder contractions, whereas norepinephrine causes bladder relaxation. Therefore, in people with overactive bladders and urinary incontinence, beta-3 adrenergic agonists can be used. Vibegron is a recently approved medication within this category. Now let's see how these medications act. On the bladder neck, beta-3 adrenergic receptors are located. When they are activated, they increase cyclic AMP levels in the muscle, which brings relaxation. Both Mirabegron and Vibegron can activate these receptors, resulting in the relaxation of the bladder. This increases bladder volume, which improves urinary holding capacity in the bladder. Therefore, both urinary frequency and urinary incontinence are relieved. These drugs are available as tablets and they can be taken by mouth. In terms of side effects, beta-3 agonists mainly produce headaches, nausea, diarrhea, flushing, and cold-like symptoms. When they are used for a long time, they may cause urinary retention. Third group of drugs are the antidepressants. Surprisingly, a few antidepressants can also be used to control bladder overactivity. Imipramine is an old generation tricyclic antidepressant that is widely used for overactive bladder. It is also used to control nocturnal enuresis or bedwetting in children. However, the dose used for this purpose is very low compared with the dose used for treating depression. Generally, it is given at a dose of 25 mg for bedwetting in children. Disipramine is another TCA used for overactive bladder. It is a dextroisomer of imipramine. TCAs work by increasing the levels of monoamines like norepinephrine and serotonin in the brain. However, these two antidepressants have high anticholinergic activity on the bladder. Thereby, they can induce bladder relaxation. This again improves the symptoms of an overactive bladder, reducing urinary urgency and incontinence. Since they block the actions of acetylcholine, they produce side effects similar to those of anticholinergics. Therefore, dry mouth, dry eyes, blurred vision, and constipation are few of the important side effects of TCAs. Duloxetine is a serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, commonly known as SNRI. It can be used to reduce urinary incontinence, which is often associated with stress. Many of these antidepressants are not approved by the FDA for treating overactive bladder. However, they are used off-label for treating urinary problems. The side effects of duloxetine are similar to those of TCAs. In addition, it can cause fatigue and insomnia. Next one, hormones. Sometimes bladder problems may arise due to a hormonal imbalance. Particularly in women, a lack of estrogen can make supportive tissues weaken around the bladder and urethra. This results in voiding problems and urinary incontinence. Especially after menopause, women may face these problems due to insufficient estrogen levels. In such cases, topical estrogen cream can be used to control these symptoms. However, it is intended for women with estrogen deficiency only. Finally, neurotoxins. Neurotoxins are the chemicals that inhibit neuronal signaling and even damage neurons. However, when they are used at low doses, they can inhibit the neuronal conduction. Botulinum toxin A is a type of compound that produces muscle relaxation locally when given by injection. It can block the actions of acetylcholine in the bladder, thereby producing relaxation. A single injection can produce the relief from the symptoms of an overactive bladder within a few days. However, its effect is not permanent and symptoms may reappear within a few months. Therefore, another dose is required to relieve the symptoms. These are the various pharmacological options for treating an overactive bladder. Anticholinergics play a key role and are widely used. They can also be combined with behavioral therapy. Beta-3 agonists like Vibegron also show promising effects in the treatment. Antidepressants, hormones, and neurotoxins are used in special conditions. That's all for today. I hope this video is useful to you. Thanks for watching. Have a great day.